So we are going to move to calculation of the weld strength, and it is important that any weld joint in a structure should furnish enough strength to withstand any anticipated static or dynamic load. And the structures which are basically used in public should be built very carefully in accordance with the applicable rules, provisions and specifications. So we are going to take a look at the calculation of weld strength, and this is particularly for butt joints. So butt joints can be designed for either tension or compression. As you can see in figure A and figure B, we have got a single B butt joint and a double B butt joint. And in case of butt joint, you can see that the size of the joint is basically denoted by T, or the thickness of the plate. This is because the leg or the size of the weld is equal to the throat thickness, which is also equal to the thickness of the plates. So that is why we are going to use T in the calculations. So if we want to determine the load, how much load is acting and how much is the tensile strength which is required, or how much is the tensile strength for and how much load we can apply. So the formula is given as P is equals to the thickness of the plate multiplied by the length multiplied by the tensile strength. So by interchanging load and tensile strength, you can determine various values. Same is the case for double V butt joint. For double V butt joint, we can see is that we have got an upper groove and a lower groove. So both have their own thickness. So this is basically denoted by T1 for upper and T2 for lower. So the overall strength P is equals to T1 plus T2 multiplied by the length of the plate multiplied by the tensile strength sigma T. The weld can either be CJP or PJP. CJP mean complete joint penetration, and PJP mean partial joint penetration. As you can see in figure ABC are CJP example, and figure D, F and G are example of PJP, and these are important for subsequent weld calculations which you will see in the next slide. So when it comes to designing fillet welds, there are basically two stresses which are involved. Number one is normal stress and number two is shear stress. And the normal stress is acting basically within the plane, within the planes of the plates which are to be required to be joined. And the shear stress basically occurs exactly at the joint interface. And since we know that stress is equal to load over area, and shear stress is basically load over shear area, and allowable stress times effective area is equal to the allowable load. So we need to see what is the allowable stress. Allowable stress is basically based on this stress strain graph which we can see. And basically we want a material to be within the limits, within the failure limits, so that it is well below the failure limit and it will not fail once the load is applied. So what we do is, if you will look at this stress strain graph, we have got sigma UTS, which is the ultimate tensile strength, and sigma yield strength, from where the plastic deformation starts. So we want to basically design our material based on the yield strength from where the plastic deformation start, and this is our reference strength. So safety factor is something that we include, and safety factor is basically the sigma s over sigma I. Sigma s is the yield strength or the reference strength divided by the allowable stress which we are going to allow for our material. So the higher is the safety factor, the more is our material to be safe, and more lesser would be the allowable strength. So if we look at Japanese codes and guidelines, then we see that they have got different guidelines and different factor of safety for steel and for bridge. And then they have got once again different factor for CJP, complete joint penetration, and PJP, partial joint penetrative joints. So if we look at allowable stress, normal stress sigma A, this is equals to sigma YS, yield strength divided by 1.5 for steel structures, and for steel bridges it is in the factor of safety increases to 1.7. And if we look at allowable stress for allowable shear stress, then this is equals to sigma YS over 1.5 whole divided by root 3. So both of them have different formula, and in the subsequent numericals we will be using these formulas for the calculation of yields, fillet, throat, fillet, effective length, etc. So in the next section we were going to look at what is fillet throat. Here are some examples for throat for a butt joint as well as for fillet joint. As you can see, A, which is equals to the throat for butt joint, is same as the thickness of the material. And if the thickness of one plate is lesser, then the A becomes the thickness of the lesser plate. If we take a look at the fillet well, then A and S are related. S is the leg and A is the throat. So the formula for A is equals to leg divided by root 2, which is equals to 0.7 times S. And if you look at the required weld size for fillet joints, different standards have been given by AAWS, American Welding Society, or API, American Petroleum Institute, or Japanese Construction Institute, etc. And here are some examples for design guidelines for steel bridges and steel structures, and for Japanese Society of Civil Engineering, and then we have got American Welding Society D1.1, where thickness and leg size are specified. Now that we know about the throat and the leg size, let's move on to normal and shear stress calculation for fillet weld. And for fillet weld, because there are more than one fillets which are involved in a weld, we have got sigma normal stress is equals to load applied whole divided by the summation of A into L. What is summation of A into L? So as many as are the number of fillets involved, S are the product of A into L. So A is the throat, L is the effective length. So if I've got three lengths, then I will multiply the throat of each length multiplied by the length plus the throat length of each the second member times the length of the weld, and so on. So that is why summation is used for both sigma normal stress and shear stress. And the effective length is basically the number of welds or the amount of length of the weld which has been performed on a workpiece. And we will look at some Japanese construction codes and what they say about the effective length. So the Japanese construction code requires that to transmit stress, an effective fillet length should be more than 10 times the fillet size. And by fillet size, we mean the leg of the fillet. So next, we are going to move to the calculations which are involved for determining the strength of fillet welds.